This morning I'm having Cameron help me with my PowerPoint presentation of the sermon that's called A Storm Is a Brewin. Stop the Hate. In the United Church of Christ, we have pledged ourselves to a new endeavor, and we are praying and striving and working towards to be united in Christ's love. And through Christ's love, we find that there is a just world for all. Many of us are saddened by the events that happened this weekend. Some of us might have even thought, if those people would have just stayed home, the people that were there carrying rifles and shields and weapons of war would not have gotten out of control. Bell Hooks writes, I want there to be a place in the world where people can engage in one another's differences in a way that is redemptive, full of hope and possibility. Not this, in order to love you, I must make you something else. That's what domination is all about. That in order to be close to you, I must possess you, remake, and recast you. The pictures that we are going to see this morning are going to be chilling for some of us. They are pictures of hate. There's a quote here from 1 John 4:20. It says, if a man say, I love God and hateth his brother, he is a liar. For he that loveth not his brother, whom he hath seen, how can he love God whom he hath not seen? It's a question that resounds in my heart. And if you ever want to know what is the whole gospel in a few short pages, read 1 John. It is a gospel, or it is a testimony to the love of Christ and what it means to be faithful followers. Today we are called to confront the storm of racism. It's something that I say with trepidation. It's something that I am surprised that I have to say in 2017. See, when I was growing up, they told us about the 1960s. They told us about race riots. They told us about how we were past racism and hatred, that we were in a better place. If you don't deal with something, you are inevitably likely to keep repeating it. If you don't fully heal a trauma, you have scars that are open and weeping. The word trauma in Greek means wound. I believe our country is still suffering from the traumas of slavery. Wounds that have not fully healed and are still festering. This friend of mine is Reverend Jesse Jackson. Now, this isn't the Reverend Jesse Jackson many of us know, but this is Reverend Jesse Jackson, who is a Disciples of Christ minister in the greater Oklahoma City area. Yesterday, he said on his Facebook page, if you attend church and not one word is said about today, get your Bible and leave. Wow, those are bold statements. I was talking with my mother about this issue of race and church. I said, you know, now that I think about it, growing up, I never heard about what was going on racially within the church. I never heard a sermon talking about the ways that we could embrace and love those who are in our community. Those of us who need a special hand, those of us who don't look like us or sound like us. I'm sure I would have heard something about the Rodney King beating, but I don't recall. Something that was so monumental in our lives was pushed under the rug. Some pastor somewhere got off easy. Today we're dealing with those shortcomings. This is a picture of young white men carrying tiki torches on August 11th at the University of Virginia. They cried, "Blood and soil! Blood and soil!" Blood and soil is the phrase that comes through the agricultural program of Nazi Germany. Who would have thought we would be cheering for Nazi words in our country? What is the alt-right? Well, the Southern Poverty Law Center describes it this way. The alternative right, commonly known as the alt-right, is a set of far-right ideologies, groups, and individuals whose core belief is that white identity is under attack by multicultural forces using political correctness and social justice to undermine white people and their civilization. Characterized by heavy use of social media and online memes, alt-righters eschew establishment conservatism, skew young, and embrace white ethno-nationalism as a fundamental value. Someone asked me this morning, well, where did this word alt-right come from? It's not something that has crept out through in 2016, but it is a word that was described in a journal article in 2010 by Steve Miller. It described the current situation of those who have hate in their heart and fear that white America is under attack. Diversity equals white genocide. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hands if you believe this. It's something that I grew up with in Texas. It's a thought that is not foreign to me. If those uppity so-and-sos would just know their place, then everything would be fine. We found this at the soda fountain counters. We find it for the people who marched in Selma. We found it for the people who were at in Eastern St. Louis who spoke out against the injustices that were being had in Ferguson. If those Black Lives Matter people would just sit down and shut up, the world would be fine. Today you came in and you saw our banner. It says, be the church. Protect the environment. Care for the poor. Forgive often. Reject racism. Fight for the powerlessness. Share earthly and spiritual resources. Embrace diversity, love God, enjoy this life. Diversity equals white genocide is at odds with our covenantal faith. This is what we are talking about here. This is a statue that was erected to Robert E. Lee. It's a beautiful statue, I must say, but it is a statue that represents hate, destruction of a people, a genocide that happened to millions of African Americans who were brought over here against their will. I appreciated hearing Amazing Grace this morning when I heard the song that John Newton wrote about how he had changed his mind about what it meant to be a Christian, and that slavery and racism were incompatible with the Christian message. It is at odds. The people of Charlottesville believe that this statue of Robert E. Lee on public lands is at odds with what it means to be an American. Robert E. Lee had slaves. He beat those slaves. He kept them in deplorable conditions. And when we released those slaves, we said, "You are on your own." We are called to do justice. Reverend Seth Whistleway calls us to call 1,000 ministers to come down to his church, a congregational church in Charlottesville, Virginia. And this is what he writes. "We are asking our participants to wade into a scary and volatile situation because people of God have to show up. We need to show that God is on the side of the marginal and oppressed, who the alt-right seeks to dehumanize." These are gutsy words. These are words with chutzpah. These are words that say, "I will walk alongside you in the midst of racism and tyranny and bigotry." So, on Friday night, the pastors met. They met in one of the largest gathering places. This is the Congregational Church in Charlottesville, where they met and sang songs such as "We Shall Overcome." After the prayer vigil, suddenly torches came out of nowhere and white men were tromping down the streets. Young white men flexing their muscle. It's something that I find interesting that they chose to use torches. Torches are historically have been used to tar and feather someone. They are representative of what the Klan has used historically to incite fear in those they stand against. Tracy Blackman, who is our justice and witness minister, was there that evening, and she said, "They are coming for the church. Police all around. They won't let us go outside. Y'all, these KKK are marching with torches." This is a video.
A large crowd of alt-right supporters wielding torches marched through the University of Virginia campus last night. Police say hundreds of protesters paraded to the Thomas Jefferson statue on the steps of the university's rotunda. The march comes on the eve of Unite the Right rally set to take place tonight at Emancipation Park in Charlottesville. Thousands are expected to attend that rally. Police made no official statement on how many people were arrested there last night.
They marched to the Thomas Jefferson statue. Thomas Jefferson was known for his holding slaves. Interesting choice. I think that one's a video too.
Tiki torches marched on the grounds of the University of Virginia in Charlottesville. They chanted slogans like, Jew will not replace us, true story, and White Lives Matter, along with the known Nazi phrase, blood and soil. The march ended in skirmishes with counter-protesters, and no one was seriously injured. And today, white nationalist so-called alt-right groups are expected to gather in Charlottesville again for a Unite the Right rally, with the stated goal of saving a statue of Confederate General Robert E. Lee. And joining me now is the Reverend Tracy Blackman of the United Church of Christ. Reverend Blackman, thank you so much for being here. Now, I know you were inside of a church last night when these white nationalist marchers began converging on that Church of the University of Virginia campus. I want to play for you a little bit of sound of what they did last night, and then I want you to describe for us what you saw. So let's listen to that a little bit.
Many of us have our hair blown back, don't we? It's shocking to see a fellow colleague running for her life. Saddens me. But beyond that, I experience anger. I experience anger with the injustice in the world. I believe if you want to unite by what is right, you've got to follow Jesus. That the words of Jesus call us to love and to peace and to healing. Those are the words of what is right. Those are the words that give us knowledge of what it means to be faithful followers. Many people have come out with statements in the last 24 hours. This is not a comprehensive list by any means, and at 8 o'clock this morning, I stopped taking statements. Governor Kasich has said, "There is no place in America for the violence and vicious hatred coming from white nationalists, KKK and neo-Nazi groups. They are corrupting our country's greatness. America can and must be better. The violence and hate must stop." Senator Rob Portman said, "The tragedy in Charlottesville this afternoon was domestic terrorism. We must all condemn hatred and white nationalism." Often when we hear about radical Islamists, we are hear that, well, why aren't those Muslims condemning those radical Islamists? Today, as white people, we are called to shout down white nationalism. We are called to stand up and act our creed. Senator Sherrod Brown said, "I stand with my Republican colleague," meaning Rob Portman. "This was domestic terrorism. We must all condemn white nationalism." Congressman Tim Ryan said, "The beliefs of the hate-filled racist and neo-Nazis who instigated the horrific events of the last day are un-American and have no place in our civilized society. Today was a sad day for the United States. Much work has to be done to dispel the bigotry that persists. That starts with calling it for what it is at entry level of government, including the White House." President Donald Trump said, "We condemn in the strongest possible terms this egregious display of hatred, bigotry, and violence on many sides. It's been going on for a long time in our country. Not Donald Trump, not Barack Obama. This has been going on for a long, long time." President Trump went on to say that we must stand up for the children who are frightened and the innocent lives that are threatened. Many this morning have said this statement was not enough, that we must call out white nationalists. We must call out the bigotry that is among us. So we're called to get out of the boat. We're called to get out of our comfort zone. The sea is choppy, waves are crashing in over our heads. Racism has reared its ugly head. We still have that Confederate flag flying proudly, but with much shame in our backyard. We are called to be a people of faith and focus on what it means to be followers of Christ. We are supposed to look into God's face and look and know that there is something more for us. It is when we have self-doubt, when we have fear, when we take our eyes off of God that we begin to sink. I believe our country has sunk morally this past weekend. Brittany, a UCC blogger in Charlottesville, writes, "I am fully convinced that Jesus would use his body to protect the most violated and most marginalized." She wrote this on August 7th this year, writing about what it means to confront racism. We are called to take up our crosses and follow Jesus. We are called to put ourselves in harm's way when it means that we stand up for what is right. We are called when the waves come to focus on Jesus. Now, I want to say this, that when I was growing up, there's a disconnect here. Sometimes we say, focus on Jesus when life gets bad. Cut yourself off from everything that is going around you and just focus on Jesus and you'll be fine. When we focus on Jesus, we learn how to ride the waves instead of drown in them. Standing against the waves of racism, what can we do? This is a bigot.
I think being a bigot is an equal opportunity phenomenon. But in order to create a system or systemic institutionalized privilege, you have to have prejudice plus the power to institutionalize that prejudice, to put it into laws, to put it into actions, policies, procedures.
I was actually just talking with my daughter the other day, the 12-year-old, about white privilege. And she said, well, what's this research you're doing, Mom? I said, well, it's on white privilege. Well, what is that? And it's like, okay, how am I going to explain this to this 12-year-old? And I had this student from, there was an old student of mine from Brewin, Layton used to take care of our house. And I said, okay, you know Layton, right? I had to warn the neighbors that Layton's taking care of the house so that when they see this large black man going to my house, belong to this. I said, you don't have to explain to people when you walk the street to take care of a friend's cat. That's white privilege.
When young white people say, and it's a litany of things, they're making a mountain out of a molehill, they're exaggerating, they're hypersensitive, they make everything about race, all of those comments are about being able to have been in this white space for all your life and never have to think about how that was a racialized space, so that when a person of color brings up racism, to most white people, particularly young white people who have no sort of historical memory of race, let alone contemporary understanding, to them it's like, well, race wasn't in the room until you brought it up, right? Race was not a problem until the black person says it, or the Latino says it, or the Asian Pacific Islander, or the indigenous person brings it up. Then race is in the room because they've, again, never had to think of their space as racialized space because they don't know the stories of their own parents. How did their parents get that house?
Just be quiet about all this, it would go away. But it hasn't gone away. This is a picture of UCC clergy. This is a picture of Cornell West. They are lined up against militia. Their hands are put in the arms, and they are linked as a chain. Today, I would urge you that you link your hearts together. Link them together in the covenant that God is love, that love is patient, love is kind, that you're willing to stand up for what is right, even when it's hard, even when you are looking at a militia person in the eye. We've got work to do, church. We can't just sit and have a PowerPoint presentation and not act. We can't just sit and wait for the next shoe to drop. We are called to be proactive. The ministry that we are called to allows us to take history, to understand it, and when it doesn't reconcile with our Christian beliefs, that we say that this is wrong. It was wrong then, it's wrong now. My prayer for you this week is that you will begin to wrestle with what it means of having white privilege. It's something that I've never thought about until I was in college. I had a professor named Jessica Brown talk to me about what white privilege was. It didn't make any sense at the time. Well, I'm poor. I was raised by, I'm Irish. I don't have white privilege. I was mistaken. Folks, there's a storm of ruin, but God calls us to walk out in faith so that we can embrace the still speaking voice of our God that says, embrace and love all humankind. Amen.